This is July the 11th of 2021, and we're here at the Meeks Street Church of Christ, and this is Sunday, the time we come together to worship in spirit and in truth as God has directed us. We're going to look at a lesson today that talks about who we are and what we're trying to be in Christ as we look at the lesson, Christ lives in me. And we're going to try to see how that is, as God wants us to know how things work and how we ought to see the things that we ought to do in the light of Scripture. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, here the Bible says, I have been crucified with Christ, Paul says. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me, and the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. If you understand the context of what he's trying to do to help the Galatians to know about circumcision and how that's not a part of the New Testament way, that we're not to have to bind circumcision like some were doing. We're trying to tell the Galatians that unless they be circumcised and keep the law of Moses, they can't be saved. But that's not what Scripture would say. And Paul had to rebuke Peter in that same chapter, and he talks about that as well. But there's some words here that really shows us how that when we are followers of Christ, that we say goodbye to the life of sin and the life, like Paul would say, to the old law. He was a part of that, a Pharisee, the Pharisee, and he was one who persecuted the early church. And for that, and for many of those reasons, he would talk about his old life in ways that that's the way I used to be formerly, but now there's something different in my life. And it's no longer that way with Paul. Paul had completely taken over the preaching and the teaching of Christ as we was before he was opposed to the teaching and preaching of Christ. I want to talk about, though, how you and I can have Christ dwell with us. What does that mean exactly? And how does that really work, you might say? Well, let's look at some scriptures and see how that is. And number one, we'll talk about as Christ dwells in my heart by faith. As we think about the heart, it's not the blood pump, but it's the mind and the intellect and the emotions and the understanding of man. All that man is, his intellect, will, and all that, is in what we would call the Bible heart. And it refers to everything of who we are. That's part of what we do. We obey from the heart the teachings of Christ. And as Christ dwells in us by faith, Revelation chapter 3, verse 20, I want to look at first of all, talks about the church there at Laodicea that had a lot of things that were going for them. They were rich, but actually Jesus would say you're poor. And he was talking about how some need to come and to open the door of their heart and let Jesus in. You may think, well, they're already Christians. They're not someone that's outside the body of Christ. But yet they need to open up the door. Evidently, there are some practices there, things that were causing them to not have Jesus in their heart. And we need Jesus in our heart. It's by faith that he dwells in our hearts. And it's not something he does physically, as we understand that's not the point of that. It's not physical, but when we take in everything about Jesus, his life and who he is, his teaching, his commandments, all of that makes us a follower. When we decide I'm going to follow Jesus and make him the Lord of my life, that's part of what we are doing as we obey the gospel and search for the way to God. As God gives us in the book, the word of God, the New Testament today, for us to follow him. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 17 makes it plain. It says that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you being rooted and grounded in love. And so every time I pick up the New Testament and I read about the life of Christ, and I even read about the words of Paul that actually Jesus gave to Paul to write down for you and I today, I can, by faith, have Jesus in my heart because I'm letting Jesus be in me as I respect and honor and obey his teachings. And so he dwells in our hearts in that way. It's through faith, through the faith of the Word of God itself. And we also think about, as we think about how Christ can dwell in us, how Christ lives in me, is that as I am a letter of Christ or an epistle written by men. And you think about what Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 3. And we'll look at some other scriptures there. Verse 2 actually gives us some more information about that. But notice that it says in verse 2, actually I'm going to begin with verse 1. It says, are we beginning to commend ourselves again? Or do we need as some letters of commendation or to you or from you? You are our letter, written in our hearts, known and read by all men. Being manifested, you are a letter of Christ. Paul says, I don't need a letter of commendation from you because you are that. You know, as men read that by all the things that you do and the service to Christ that you're doing. But notice verse 3 says, being manifested that you are a letter of Christ or epistle of Christ, cared for us, written not with in ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. And that again refers back to the Old Testament that was written on tablets of stone. And those stones were the Ten Commandments, the Decalogue, as we refer to them as. And so we don't have to have physically these things, these words, commandments, but you know, we have that in our hearts. You know, as people see us, as we understand, we are every day, people are looking at us. And you may be the only Bible that they'll ever see. They may not ever open the scriptures themselves unless they see you and the example that you're giving. And they will see Christ in you. Just like what Paul would say in Galatians 2, verse 20, how that Christ lives in me. And people, when they see Paul, they could actually see Christ living inside of him. And the same ought to be true of us. As we let Christ's teachings dwell in us, we are people who are in some ways representatives. We are light reflectors of that true light, which is Jesus. And we'll talk more about that as far as our example is concerned. These are similar in some ways. But in John chapter 15, verse 7, he says, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Again, that talks about how that we let the words abide in us. And that's how we can do that, how Christ dwells in us. It reminds me what David said a long time ago in Psalms 119, verse 11, that your word have I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. Well, this is true in this sense. We let the words of Christ dwell within us. We learn the teachings of Christ, and we have the, all the things that are taught there. We'll talk more about that in just a few moments. As we are talking about here, that as Christ's teachings are exemplified through me, as others, and we think about all of us as body of the Christ and those who are followers of Christ, the word exemplified simply means that the words, the examples, I should say, is something you're a typical example of a follower of Christ. And John 14, verse 23 tells us, Jesus answered and said to him, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. And my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our abode with him. That's talking about how Christ and God, the Father, would all come and would have fellowship with him as we love and keep his words. And that's one of the great things about being a follower of Christ is we actually follow the teachings of Christ. Now, we can't say we're a follower of Christ if we're not doing what Jesus said to do. Now, we are paying close attention to the things that Jesus says. His words mean everything to us. As a disciple of Christ, those who follow him, you look at Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7 about what Jesus said about being poor in the spirit and how that we are to be humble in that way. And then there's the pure in heart that will see God. And we all take that to heart as the meaning you might say. We take that in a way that I've got to be pure as I can because it's the pure in heart. I cannot let anything corrupt me and keep on corrupting my life and cause me to miss heaven. And then there is the idea of being peacemakers, those who actually want peace and pursue peace. That's part about having that exemplified in my life. I cannot be an antagonistic person, someone who loves trouble and controversy just for controversy's sake. No, we've got to stand for the truth without being contentious. In the sense of overly contentious and simply making messes wherever we go. But we want to strive for the truth and have Christ be exemplified through us. And as I do that, that's when I let the word of God, the word of Christ, dwell in me, and I'm keeping his teachings. I'm not doing things that are wrong. I'm turning the other cheek, and I am going the extra mile that he talks about there. I'm the one who, if I have a fault against my brother, will go to that brother and to him privately about that, Matthew 18. But also in chapter 6, 5 and 6, talks about different things. He also, in that Sermon on the Mount, talks about if you have aught against your brother, you ought to lay your gift down at the altar and go and be reconciled to your brother, then to give your gift. And so that's part of what we do. That's all our life, isn't it? To do the will of God through that. And so we are to exemplify that. As Paul would say in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, that be imitators of me, just as I also am of Christ. And that says a lot about, we could look at Paul as an example of what it means to be like Christ. He's saying, I'm imitating Christ, and you can imitate me in that regard. Have you ever seen someone that you think of being a very spiritual person and say, well, you know, I want to be like that person because he's following Christ in so close a manner that it's drawing me to be like Christ? Well, that's exactly what Paul is advocating here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1. And then, as Jesus works through me to do the things that we need to do, in Philippians chapter 2, verse 13, the Bible says, for it is God who is at work in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure. And so he's talking about there how God works in us. Well, how does he work with us? You understand, we are the hands, the feet, and the mouthpiece, and the eyes, you might say, in a lot of ways, of God, and doing the work that God has given us to do. It's like when Jesus was coming here on behalf of the Father. As you understand, Jesus in John chapter 10, verses 37, 38 says, if I do not the works of my Father, do not believe me. But if I do them, though you do not believe me, believe the works. In other words, Jesus is saying, look at the works that I'm doing that's from the Father. He goes on to say, so that you may know and understand that the Father is in me and I in the Father. He's talking about the fact that Christ was in the Father because he's doing the works of the Father. And the Father was in him because it was all that the Father sent him to do. Jesus was accomplishing those very works. And so that's how that is. It's not some, well, Jesus is the Father, as some have errantly said, erroneously have said, well, Jesus and God the Father and the Holy Spirit are all one person. No, that's not the teaching of that. Jesus saying, I am in the Father when I'm doing the works of the Father. And chapter 14, verses 7 to 11 also bears this out. Look what the Bible says here in John chapter 14. I want you to think about some of the things there that leads us to know how we can be in Jesus. I believe there's a parallel here. In John 14, remember the great story of, actually the great words of Jesus, I should say, in John 14 about the mansions or dwelling places that are in heaven that Jesus would go to prepare. And he talks about how, in verse 6, that he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. In verse 7, if you had known me, you would have known my Father also. From now on you know him and have seen him. That's where Philip comes, the next verse, and says, Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been so long with you, yet you have not come to know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? He's making a point very emphatically, isn't he? The fact that when you look at Christ, you're seeing exactly what the Father would do if he was there. It's like a father and son relationship where they're both on the same page and they're not having any controversy. They're not having any disagreements whatsoever. And that's the way Jesus is with us. He is completely in tune with the Father. And when we are completely in tune with him, and we are doing the works that Jesus sends us to do, then we know that we have done what God says. I want you to notice one more passage. In John 9, verse 4, the Bible tells us, we must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. The night is coming when no one can work. Now, most translations, like the Old King James, maybe the New King James as well, have this idea that I must work. This is actually translated that way. But the New American Standard, the ESV, and some others actually have this from different manuscripts that is talking about in the plural sense, that we must work the works of him who sent me as long as it is day. And that tells us a lot about day and night, referring to death and why we have time and opportunity in the day to do the works that God has given us. Jesus specifically talking about his death on the cross, that night when it's coming, that no one can work. But he's making application for you and I as well in that passage, in the plural sense of following him and doing the works that Jesus would have us to do. And another way that Christ is in me is as Christ uses my influence to his glory. Everything we do is to be the glory of God, and that we should not be looking for glory ourselves. We're not be someone that's wanting, desiring the praises of men at all, really, because it's Christ who has done everything. He's the one who went to the cross to die for us. And God is the one who has done so much for us that we should not look at ourselves as ones that are deserving of any praise. And that's what humility speaks to in that regard. Matthew chapter 5, though, he talks about how in verse 14, you are a light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. And it gives light to all who are in the house. Let your light so shine before men in such a way that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Those words of Jesus, they should mean something to us in the area of influence and how that really when we're doing the works of God and we're letting our light shine before men, it's not to our praise. Like I said, that's what the Pharisees were doing. They stand on the street corner, would pray before men to be seen by men. They would announce that they were giving alms to the poor or someone, and they'd blow with a trumpet as if that was something that they had to draw attention to. They did it for their own glory. But yet Jesus says, it's for the Father's glory, that you maybe see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. And so as Jesus lives in us and that we are exerting the influence that we need to have as a child of God, a good influence, an example to others, that's how Christ uses my influence to his glory. 2 Thessalonians 1, 11 and 12 also says, right after talking about the end times and how that when Christ comes in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them who know not God and obey not the gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, then he goes back to the present and says these words about that particular thing. He says, to this end also we pray for you always, that our God will count you worthy of your calling and fulfill every desire for goodness and the work of faith with power, so that the name of our Lord Jesus will be glorified in you. Notice that. That Jesus could be glorified by the church there at Thessalonica, by men doing the work of God and exerting an influence in that work. He says, and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. Again, that's all talking about how we and I need to be. That's why we have to be a good example to others, because it glorifies God. And as I proclaim Jesus' suffering and death on the cross to the world, I am actually having Christ in me. As we talk about the Lord's Supper, that we take on the first day of the week and every first day of the week, because every week has a first day. And the Bible tells us that the disciples came together on the first day of the week to take the Lord's Supper. It wasn't a particular month or a year that's talked about in difference to that, but it's talked about how they came together for that very purpose. And Paul gave instructions about how to not do the Lord's Supper. Don't make a common meal out of it. But he also wanted to give instructions about why you take it and how you need to take it in a manner worthy. And that's talking about the fact that you do it, you ascribe the worth that needs to be given to the Lord's Supper. That's really how you do it. It's an adverb describing your action. And if you do it without discerning the Lord's body, then you're not ascribing the worth to the body of Christ or the blood of Christ that needs to be there. And then in verse 23, I want to read, says, for I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, But the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me." Now that phrase, "as oft as you drink it," means every time you take it. Every time you come together, you're doing this for this very purpose. There's not a time that we take the Lord's Supper that our mind should not be on the cross and on the fact that Jesus died for me, gave his body and also gave his blood for my salvation and your salvation. It says, "In remembrance of me, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." That tells us, as we commune with Christ, you know, in some sense, we're going back in the time of Jesus and thinking about things that happened thousands of years before you and I could ever be a part of the salvation today. But yet, even though that, we see Jesus wants us to have fellowship with him, and we do that. We have fellowship with him every time. We have communion with him every time as we take the body of Christ, the emblems of that, the bread, unleavened bread, and the fruit of the vine there. Then number 7, as Christ suffers when I suffer. In Acts chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. And I have verses 4 and 5 on the chart here. But in Acts chapter 9, I want to read what the context is. We know Saul of Tarsus, before he became Paul the Apostle, was one who persecuted the church. And that's exactly where Luke tells us. We see the story of Saul of Tarsus begin. It says, "So now Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked for letters from him to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if he found any belonging to the way, both men and women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. And as he was traveling, it happened that he was approaching Damascus, and suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him." And that's where he sees the light, not only physically, but spiritually. His life is forever changed. He says in verse 4, the Bible tells us, "And he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, 'Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?' And he said, 'Who are you, Lord?' And he said, 'I am Jesus whom you are persecuting.'" That tells us a lot about his experience with Jesus. That's exactly what happened when he met Jesus for the first time, the one he was persecuting. You know, until this time, he thought he was right in going and persecuting the church, taking Christians out of their homes and casting them into prison. He held the coats in chapter 7 when Stephen was stoned to death, the first martyr there that began the great persecution there of the church. But yet, one thing about this is, the point I'm making, Christ is saying, "You're hurting my body, and yet it hurts me as well. You're persecuting me." Because as we understand, the church is the bride of Christ. They are married in some respect to Jesus. And in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 26, here's the practical side of this. As we know that if one member suffers, all the members suffered with it. And if one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. That's what we're supposed to do as children of God. That's the goal of us, is to properly feel for one another. As we understand, there's pain sometimes, suffering. There's also times of rejoicing. We're to rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who are to weep. And that's talking about how Jesus would even suffer when his body is being in some ways persecuted. That's what chapter 9 speaks to. And so as Christ suffers, I suffer. That's how Christ lives inside of me, because I'm one of his. And Jesus would say, when he's persecuted, you're persecuting me in that way. And as also, as I wear Christ's name. In 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 14 to 16, Peter says, "If you are approached from the name of Christ, blessed are you, for the Spirit of glory and of God rest upon you. On their part he is blasphemed, but on your part he is glorified. But let none of you suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, a busybody in other people's matters. Yet if anyone suffer as a Christian, let him not be ashamed, but glorify God in this matter." And so when we suffer for wearing the name of Christ, Christ is in us and we are in Christ, because we are not ashamed to wear the very name of Christ And we're actually glorifying Christ by wearing that name. Notice what it says in James chapter 2, verses 6 and 7. You know, the word name Christian is not mentioned there. It's implied in some ways. He's talking about the name that we wear that reflects about Christ. He says, but you have dishonored the poor man. Talking about the rich who do these things against the church. Do not the rich oppress you and drag you into the courts? Do they not blaspheme that noble name by which you're called? And James would have some things to say about that as well. But you know, what is that noble name that we're called by? And I believe he's talking about the name Christian. It's not a slang that those people around them would say. Well, these are the names for people who are call themselves Christians or they're Christ-like. Now, I believe this is a divine name that God gave us to wear and to be glorifying Christ by wearing the name Christian. As Christ says, come through me, as he offers the invitation. That's what number 9 we have, that Christ, when he says, come to me, that's how he's in me and I in him. In a sense, Revelation 22, verse 17 says, and the Spirit and the bride say, come, let him who hears say, come. Let him who thirsts come. Whoever desires, let him take the water of life freely. This is an invitation for those outside the body of Christ to come in. And he's talking about the Spirit and the bride. Well, who is the bride? The bride referring to the church that Jesus established. And that Ephesians chapter 5 talks about how Christ is married to the church and it's his wife. And he's the head of that wife and husband relationship as we understand that passage teaching. But as the church says, come, you know, we're saying the words of Jesus. You know, that's one thing that Jesus said a long time ago in Matthew chapter 11, verses 28 through 30, that come to me, all who are laboring and are heavy laden, I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek or gentle and lowly, and you will find rest for your souls. And so that tells us a lot. He said, for my yoke is easy, my burden is light. He's telling us a lot about how we can come to him and have that great invitation of salvation through and by our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And finally, I want to talk about briefly, when does Christ live in me? When is it that I can have all the things we've talked about here in this lesson today? Well, first of all, I want to suggest it's when I obey the gospel of Christ. Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 through 29, it begins by faith, and it also leads us to be baptized for the name of Jesus Christ, or in the name of Jesus Christ. Galatians chapter 3 tells us here, I want to read this passage. Verse 26 says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Christ Jesus, for all of you have been baptized into Christ, have clothed yourselves, or put on Christ, as other translations have. There's neither Jew nor Greek. There's neither slave nor free. There is neither male nor female, for you are all one in Jesus Christ. That's what the unity of the church and how that there's no distinction in salvation to anyone. Anybody can be saved who wants and desires to come to Jesus. And in verse 29, and if you belong to Christ, then you're Abraham's descendants, heirs according to the promise. God made Abraham a promise a long time ago that he would have more descendants than the sands of the sea and the stars and in the sky, and that how you and I are part of that. When we obey the gospel, Christ lives within us. And he didn't know exactly who that seed was, but that seed, but through your seed, all nations be blessed, was talking about Christ. As we wear the name of Christ, as we put on Christ in baptism, as that last step that puts us into the family of God, then we can know that Christ is in us. In conclusion, I want to read in Colossians chapter 1, verses 26 to 29. Here, I believe he sums up a lot of things that I've talked about in the lesson. And you'll notice there's a lot of points he makes that, you know, I just can't put this in one of these points. But I want to read, begin with verse 26. I'm talking about the mystery here. It says in verse 26, that is the mystery which has been hidden from the past ages and generations, but now has been manifested to his saints, to him to whom God willed to make known what is the riches of the glory of this ministry or this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. If Christ is in us, we have the hope of one day being glorified with Jesus. As the Bible tells us, that one day that will happen, as the Bible is right in saying. Notice what it says, and it goes on to say, verse 28, we proclaim him, admonishing every man and teaching every man with all wisdom, that we may be present, or we may present, every man complete in Christ. Our goal is to try to get people to be like Christ and to present them like Christ. One day that will truly take place. We'll present the church as that unspotted, unblemished church. The bride of Christ will be delivered to Jesus, and he'll give that to the Father. But the Bible tells us, last verse, for this purpose also I labor, striving according to his power, which mightily works within me. God works within us. When we do his will, we do his commandments, we follow his way, Christ dwells in our hearts by faith, and in everything we're doing, we're striving to seek first the kingdom, and all this righteousness and all these things be added unto us. The temporal needs, we'll see that. Hope you've enjoyed the lesson of the hour today. Hope it's been beneficial to you to know how Christ can live within you. If you're outside the body of Christ and he does not live in you yet, but you can, by obeying the gospel, turn away from sin. But the Bible says it starts by faith. Hearing the word of God is the way we come to faith, Romans 10, verse 17. And that we repent of our sins, Luke 13, 3. Jesus says, I tell you nay, but except you repent, you shall all likewise perish. And then confess Christ to be the Son of God and be immersed, baptized for the very remission of your sins. There's where the blood of Christ washes away our sins. Not the water, but it's the blood of Christ that will take care of all of your sins, blots out all your sins, your past sins. If you desire to do that, why don't you do that while you have time and opportunity? And until we meet again, have a good day, and God bless.